nice and quickly, we want to talk about pet obesity. Now, Sandy, you, you're a vet from Vitalpet, obviously, which is in the Marbella area.
Yeah.
And do you see many overweight dogs that come into your practice?
Yes, it's a major problem nowadays.
It's a major
yes,
problem, isn't
actually,
it?
Yes, actually, it's 40% of all the dogs are obese or slightly overweight.
Wow.
That's quite a lot.
That's a big number.
Yeah.
That's ridiculous.
Unbelievable. 40%.
Major nutritional problem, obesity.
Yeah, absolutely. And it goes hand in hand with humans as well, doesn't it? Because
it does.
Obviously there's a
lifestyle,
lot of overweight
yeah.
humans that are out there. Now, what's the cause of this problem? Do you have a theory behind that?
Well, I mean, the theory behind that is very easy. As in humans, are you eating too much or are you moving little for what you're eating?
Absolutely.
So, yeah, I think it has to do very much with the lifestyle people have nowadays. And, you know, pets are kept in more time, getting less walks and getting good food, a lot of treats, a lot of snacks, extra snacks. And that's probably the problem.
Absolutely, yeah. Now, there's a couple of different points that I'd like to cover there, but first and foremost, exercise has gone down a lot, hasn't it, between the owner and their pet dog.
Mm-hmm,
Not as many people are out walking as they should be.
Yeah, because they have no time or whatever.
Busy lifestyle says that we can't necessarily get out as much as we would like to, although get up earlier, that's my answer to that. what sort of problems comes along with pet obesity?
Well, obviously, articulation problems, arthritis, circulation problems, hormonal problems could be either inducing obesity or due to obesity, diabetes, all that kind of stuff. So it's not a good thing.
It's a major problem, isn't it? It's not just the dog's a little bit chubby and he'll be fine. There are some serious medical side effects to that.
Exactly.
Now, you mentioned diabetes there.
Mm-hmm.
Is diabetes being driven by dogs that are overweight?
Not 100%, but yes, obese dogs tend to get diabetes. It's the same like in human people, yes.
Right, okay. Now, there are a lot of different foods out on the market at the moment,
mm-hmm.
and some of them have you know, weight loss schemes and various different other programs that you can get involved if your dog is overweight.
Mm-hmm.
But as you say at the beginning, it's actually quite simple, isn't it? It's don't feed the dog as much and take him out for more walks.
Exactly.
Now,
depending always on the grade of obesity, because if you have a really, really overweight Labrador and the owner from one day to the other decides, well, we need to exercise him, it probably will end with sore articulations and can't move, and that can't be good either. So, slow.
So it's about easing the dog into more exercise, not necessarily taking her out on a marathon straight away.
Exactly, yeah.
Okay, that's very understandable.
Little by little.
So you say that 40% of dogs that come into your practice are overweight or obese.
Yeah, and the problem is
the owner
nearly 80% of these owners don't see it or don't recognise
yeah.
it. That's a bit the problem.
I've heard that so much.
Yes, we have heard
And some of the things I hear from people as well is they do make me smile. So I certainly, one of my customers says, but his little face, I can't not just give him a treat.
Now, I completely see where they're coming from. They want to be a little bit special towards their dog. They want to make sure that the dog thinks that they love them, you know. But how much of a serious problem is obesity? You know, is it really an issue if the dogs are obese, or is it just the lifestyle that we're in today? You know, is it something that the owner should get a grip of, or is it something that we can fly under the radar with, if you like?
No, it's certainly a subject that you should the owner should be conscious of and do something against it, because it's not good for their heart, depending on the breed, it's not good for their articulation. You need to get the dog into a good weight range.
So if somebody is out there and looking at their dog right now,
mm-hmm.
and going, well, actually, I think my dog might be a little bit tubby, how can they tell if their dog's overweight or not?
Well, by just the weight is very difficult, because there are more or less indications for every breed, but in with with every breed you have also variations, bigger or smaller dogs. So what they should look at is actually about a little bit the ribs. You should always be capable to feel them.
You can actually feel them.
Yes, okay. You should be able to slightly feel them. Not if you feel all the bones, then it's too skinny. But if you don't feel anything, only skin, no, you don't feel the ribs, then they're obese. And also the shape. If you look from above to the dog, you should be able to see the waist.
A little bit of an indentation by the waist, yeah? Now, because a lot of the dogs that we see that come into the pet lodge, not necessarily a lot of them, but some of them, haven't got a waistline. It's an actual straight...
A straight line.
And that is where the dog's overweight, isn't it? It's not just us being...
mean.
Picky.
Yes.
Okay. Now, how does your average owner take it when you tell them that their dog is...
Oh, it's like you insult them. That's the problem. It's like you're telling them they're obese. Yes, that's a bit the problem. I mean, there are other people that say, yeah, okay, it's true. It's because I have little time. Then when I come home, I give them two or three treats. And it's always two or three treats, depending. If it's a little chihuahua of 2 kilos, two or three treats might be 80% of his energetic needs of the whole day. You know?
Absolutely.
So that's a bit the problem. If you have a big Rottweiler, probably two or three sausages won't harm him.
Yeah, so... The breed does matter. If it's a tiny dog, then the amount
and
of food
and you also have certain breeds that tend to be more obese, like the Beagles or the Labradors.
Why do you think that is? Is that due to the owner or is it due to the dog, do you think?
I mean, the owner is always involved, but I mean, there's no scientific proof, but in studies we have seen that clearly, that certain breeds tend to be obese. So.
And the labs always seem to be the ones that like to stuff their faces.
Well, they don't eat, do they? Labs don't eat.
They hoover.
They just inhale food.
And the Beagles.
It's a very, very interesting subject because... The way that the world is going with the human race, we are putting weight on, and we're getting bigger and bigger, and I think that we're doing the same with our dogs. Now, the problem I have with it is that the dog, you know, those of us that are obese, medical reasons aside, then that is our choice, because we are the ones that are consuming the food. Nobody's stuffing this stuff down our faces. We're the ones that are making bad food choices, or, you know, eating junk food and that kind of stuff. The dogs haven't got that choice. We make that decision for them. So, I mean, it is a massive hang-up on mine. Now, do you think that it would be fair to say that this is animal cruelty?
I don't know if we can go that far, but... not intentionally, but in the end, as it has medical or raises up medical problems, yes, it could be.
It sounds very horrible, doesn't it? You mustn't. But you know, facts are facts. So rather than anybody offending anybody, what I want you to do, if you're listening to the radio right now, I want you to get your dog, have a little look at them, okay? And I want you to stand up. Stand up straight so you can look down onto your dog, okay? Have a look at the ribs. See if you can just feel the last two ribs. See if there's a little indentation where the waist should be. And see if you can, if it moves back out towards the hip bones, towards the rear of the dog as well. And if you've just got one straight line that runs from the ribs to the bum, you've got yourself a porker. All right?
Say it, how it is, Nando.
Listen, stop giving your dog loads and loads of treats or take them out for more and more walks. Now... We use positive reinforcement training. So, and one of the tools that we use is food. Cheese, hot dog, ham, sure. You know, the whole thing. Now, if you're doing a lot of training, one of the things that we say is you've got to cut down their main diet so that those treats are just...
Compensate,
yeah, absolutely. It's part of the daily allowance of food as opposed to adding it on top. And, of course, if you're at home and you're training in a quiet environment, then just using their normal food is enough to train with anyway. So... I don't want to hear any rubbish about positive reinforcement making my dog fat and all that sort of malarkey.
I know, the things we hear. But yes, we do always remind people, especially when they're coming to classes and things, don't give them any breakfast, guys.
Well, yeah, I mean, just use their breakfast as part of the training, you know, part of the training routine. You know, it's very, very important. Now, if you've got any questions, we do want you to get involved. So give us a call in the studio on 951-043-843. Or, of course, you can send me a text message on 951-140-223. And I'm laughing because I have a text message that's come in. This is from Jack. He says, Turns out I've got a fatty.
Uh-oh.
Very good, Jack. Now, listen, I am joined by Sandy from Vitalpet. We've got Donna Saunders in the chair, as usual. And joining me on the line, live from the UK, we've also got Jaqi Bunn. Good morning, Jaqi. How are you doing?
Yeah, I'm fine, thanks. Hi, Nando. Hi, everyone in the studio.
Hi, Jaqi.
Hi.
So, Jaqi, we're talking about pet obesity, which is a massive pet hate of mine. Now, I know it's also it's one of your pet hates as well. Why is it such a big deal for you?
It's a big deal for me. I mean, I've got a personal interest in this because I've suffered with my weight since I was a child. And so, you know, before people say, oh, well, gosh, she's overweight and she's talking about obesity. What really gets me is that we are the guardians of dogs. And if human beings want to go and mess up their lives or have sort of emotional problems with eating, as I have sometimes, that's fine. But and we can go to the doctor and get help from that. But there's no reason for dogs to be overweight except if they have a physiological condition, which most overweight dogs I see don't. It's just that their owners are their guardians, and the dogs are relying on us to control what they eat, really. That's what really gets me, is that we're letting them down.
Do you know, this is exactly what we were just saying. It is, you know, we make the choices for the dogs. It's not like they go out and go, oh, I'm going to nip through the drive-thru quickly to get myself a quarter pound of cheese. but It is quite a big point that we're making. We sound quite nasty. We sound like we're giving them a hard time. Do you think? Obviously the owners aren't being horrible to their dogs, are they? They're not, or not intentionally being horrible. But for me, this is borderline cruelty. How do you feel about it?
I absolutely agree with you. I mean, working in rescue, I've dealt with some pretty emaciated dogs. And funnily enough, you don't get many dogs coming into rescue, and certainly not in my breeds, that are overweight. But I agree with you completely. It's a form of abuse because it's dealt out by humans. You don't get, if you study village dogs and feral dogs, funny, you don't see any overweight dogs living out in the wild, fending for themselves. Only pet dogs.
That's a very, very good point. We pass a lot of strays because we're out in the campo, which is Spanish for countryside. We are really stuck out in the mountains, if you like, and we pass quite a few stray dogs, and you never, ever see an overweight dog. In fact, most of the village dogs are, if anything, a little underweight, aren't they, Don?
Yes, and I think a lot of that is because the people that live out in the campo allow their animals to live off the land.
Yeah, they do, but they've also got a lot more free range, haven't they?
Yeah, they kind of please themselves, don't they?
Yeah, I mean, a lot of the, especially, I'm not suggesting this is right or wrong, but a lot of the Spanish owners will leave their dogs out to walk themselves. Sandy, is this something that you come across down on the coast?
Not really, because obviously over here it's too dangerous to let the dog out. I mean, we have a lot of traffic and So, but you could see it before, yes, some years ago you had it. And, I mean, if you go a little bit further to the urbanizations, then you can see them. There are a lot of dogs. They're not walked. They're just, you know, they open the door and they're out all day. And then you can see these dogs are not obese.
Okay. So, Jaqi, you're from the Kent area, is that right?
That's right.
And do you see a large number of dogs that are overweight, or is it just the odd one that you're seeing?
It's getting worse. Without a doubt, Kent tends to be the hunt and shoot and fishing kind of dog, spaniels, labradors, gun dogs, that kind of thing. But it is getting worse. I'm seeing a lot more dogs that are getting to the point where you know you think that dog is overweight, that's getting obese. And I've seen some absolute whoppers. I mean, it's usually, sadly, it's usually the smaller breeds for some reason. I don't know whether I'm just not seeing many big breeds becoming overweight in Kent, but it's the smaller breeds. I mean, I've seen some very sad spaniels lately that really couldn't do half an hour's work, let alone 8 hours in the field.
That's really interesting.
It's getting worse.
That's very interesting that it's the smaller breeds. And Sandy, what about you? Is it small, big? What sort of dogs are you seeing that are overweight?
I think it's all kind of breeds. We see, well, I mean, the labs are a special problem. No, but I mean, you don't see a fat German Shepherd. That's true. But you can see, I mean, the Golden Retrievers, they're slight to be obese as well, and some pointers, and yeah, they do. But it's, I think Jackie's right. It's more the small breeds. It's probably because the owners of big breeds, they treat them more as dogs, and they can be outside and
so
don't get spoiled as much as
the little absolutely
ones.
Now, Sandy, how do you, if somebody comes in and you've got a dog that's overweight, how do you advise the owner what they should do?
We usually weigh the dog every time he comes in the clinic, so we've got the weight control, and we've got also a poster which the other listener said you can see actually obese, a skinny and a normal dog, and try to make them see it. And I mean, you have to be very gentle. You can't just go directly to the owner, because they often feel insulted. And yes, but first thing is, we have to rule out that there's a medical problem, like a hormonal problem or whatever. Then you have to see age and breed and other circumstances, and then you have to find out if dog is just eating too much, or is he just exercising too very little? And depending also on the grade of obesity, I mean, if it's just slightly overweight, probably just dropping a little bit of the intake is fine. If not, you have to go over to a special plan to lose weight with a special diet and also an exercise plan.
The tact side of it with a customer is very difficult, because you've got to really drill into what they're feeding as well, don't you?
And they don't admit.
Exactly. It's very difficult trying to actually find out just how many treats they get in between the meals, and
exactly,
the size of the meals, and et cetera, et cetera.
And if they say they give them two or three, they probably give them five or six.
Yeah.
So Sandy said you've got to reduce the amount of food that's being given and mm-hmm. up the exercise, considering it's not a medical problem and they've checked out healthily, and a constant weight check to make sure that they're being fed properly, or they're not gaining weight, shall I say. Jaqi, have you got any tips for owners that might have a dog that's obese?
Well, the first thing I tell owners to do is to keep a diary of what, just a note by the kettle, notepad by the kettle, you know, on the kitchen table. Just every time you pop something into your dog's mouth, or anyone pops something into the dog's mouth, because, of course, very often somebody's not, you know, somebody is actually feeding the dog on the sly, you know, at the table. But just keep a diary. Just write down words of one syllable, just every time the dog you pop something into the dog's mouth, or it picks something up from the kitchen floor as you're cooking or something. A diary is a very, very useful tool. The other thing, of course, is to ask other members of the family, because very often you'd be amazed that, well, I didn't know you were feeding him from the table, or I didn't know he went up to your room and finished off your Jaffa cakes every day, kind of thing. You know, that's the most common thing. But talking about exercise, of course, that some of the dogs that I see, that it's not so much not enough exercise, it's just the wrong kind of exercise. They're just taking them for a stroll around the streets rather than, you know, encouraging them to play or to play with other dogs. Of course, you get a lot of overweight dogs that actually have a lot of problems with other dogs. They don't get that kind of play either. It's the right type of exercise as well with a lot of these dogs. So it's usually identifying if an owner's got any problems exercising their dog, and again, keeping the diary. Those are two things I start with anyway.
I love the keeping the diary idea. That's a great suggestion, you know, because it does make you realise how much it almost brings you down to earth with a bit of a bump, doesn't it? Because sometimes you don't think you're feeding as much as you might be.
And I think, Jaqi,
no.
You touched on another great thing there, which was the feeding from the table. Now, I've come into contact with a lot of people that have never put two and two together, in that they feed their dogs their own meals, a breakfast and a dinner, dog food, but then when the owner is having their evening meal, they're actually giving them little pieces from their plate as well, and they don't kind of put the two together.
Yeah, that's right. It's done very subliminally, or even the other cases I've had have been where you've had kids eating from a high chair.
Yeah.
Of course, the kids are eating from the high chair and mum's around, but she's not watching. And, of course, kiddie thinks it's really funny to drop food for the dog to run around and catch. I've seen that so many times.
And, of course, human food can be so much higher in fat as well.
Tell me about it.
Now, that's actually a very, very interesting point, actually, because, excuse me, that it's a very important point because people don't realise how much one slice of toast with a bit of butter on is going to make a difference to, for instance, a little shih tzu called Bomber.
Absolutely, yeah.
Brown.
What?
That's low.
No, I wasn't. I didn't mention my dog's.
That
my dad's
is low.
Dogs.
He's not going to feed you tonight at
what
dinner.
What are you talking about? He won't feed me anyway. He gives it all to the dog.
Dad, I apologise in advance for the son.
Now, another point that you mentioned about the you know, they don't get the play and that kind of stuff, Jaqi. One thing that I've kind of noticed that there's a lot of dogs that are overweight, and I mean properly overweight, they suffer with joint problems, which then makes them a bit grouchy when other dogs want to come over and play, and they get a little bit defensive, so they're snappy a lot quicker because maybe they're hurting. Is this something that you would agree with or you see?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think I've said to you before that every Neapolitan Mastiff I've taken in, regardless of what their weight has been, has had joint problems, dysplasia, various other things related to joints. But without a doubt, the first thing I do is get the weight off them when they come in to me. And that makes a huge difference. Before even thinking about pain meds and going to the vet for supplements and things to help them with their joints, it's the weight makes a massive difference. And you can literally see the more active dog coming out just from having the weight off those heavy joints. It's amazing. So yeah, that's a massive problem, especially for the larger breeds.
So is it something that we would say it would be better to keep them leaner?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, not to the point where, you know, if I'm out walking my foster Neapolitan or any of the fosters I've ever had, and I've got the weight off them, it's funny. I think the British have I don't know if it's worldwide, but the British certainly have a thing about if they don't like seeing bone. And for me, yeah. I like to see the last rib on a dog and a little bit of a waist as well. But people think a dog is underfed or has been, you know, emaciated if they can see a little bit of bone and a little bit of muscle. But
I've also seen that trend. Jaqi, in that people like to see the large breeds stocky.
Well, yeah, stocky and fat are different things. They do mistake stocky for fat, or fat for stocky, shall I say. They like to call the dog stocky when actually he's a porker. and it is something that you need to be very aware of, I think. Now, one thing that you mentioned, or all of you guys have touched on, is that very quickly, other owners will say, oh, my God, that dog's really skinny. You haven't, you know, he's underfed. And they'll jump on the bandwagon straight away and say, you know, there's a problem with your dog, especially if they're greyhound or galgos or, you know, whippets, very, very slight dogs anyway. But you don't hear a lot of people turn around and say, do you know what, mate, your dog's fat. It's do you think it's because people find it more offensive?
It's not PC.
It's not PC. There it is. Is that, I mean, but at the end of the day, this is, and I'm going to say it again, it's cruelty. It's animal cruelty. It's, the dog is not making that choice. We are putting that food into the dog's mouth. Are we losing listeners as we talk?
Can you hear the pin drop?
Listen,
well, no, I mean, speaking, I think it goes deeper. And this is where human psychology has to come in as well. It's getting... I think there's a definite correlation between our society getting fatter. I think we're one of the fattest countries, fattest nations in Europe or something.
Yeah, I've heard that.
There's definitely a correlation between that rise and the rise in obesity in our dogs. Again, that's something more to delve into from a, you know, sort of the psychologist's point of view. But yeah, people get very, very offended. I mean, all my walk club members will say to you, I'll quite happily say, you know, oh, dog's put on a bit of weight over the last couple of months, you know, see if we can get some weight off. I've lost his rib, you know, and we'll make a joke of it. And I try and tell people not to take it personally. You know, it's, I mean, my dogs put on weight from time to time, but as soon as I identify that, then you know, that they get a bit more exercise or I just lower their food. It's a very simple equation.
Jaqi, I think that's another good thing is that, you know, sometimes we live with these dogs every day. Sometimes it might take somebody that hasn't seen your dog for a while to notice a difference.
Absolutely.
I've fallen victim to that myself. I've got Minky, a little snatcher bull terrier, and she is partial to getting herself a little bit of a fat ass.
She's getting old, lady.
Isn't she? And she used to be very slim, and she would lose weight very, very quickly. But now she's got older, I think
she's getting old, lady.
Her
hips.
Metabolism has slowed down, and she gets porky a lot quicker, and it takes a little bit longer to take it off. So. It's also one of those things that comes and goes, isn't it? It's not necessarily, you know, your dog's fat and that's the way it's going to be for the rest of its life. It's one of those things you need to keep an eye on. It's very easy to overlook, I think.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right, guys, I think we're going to have to take another short break. So if you're all happy to hang on, we will be back in just a minute. We are all discussing pet obesity. Now, one of the things that just came up then is... self-regulating feeding. We were talking during the break. Now, is it normal, Jaqi, I'd like you to have a little shot at this. Is it normal for dogs to self-regulate their food?
Well, funny enough, we've been talking about this amongst ourselves in the UK lately, and there's some talk about whether a dog can regulate free feeding. And there are some rescues in the States, for example, when a dog first comes in that has food guarding issues, they will actually just leave food freely available for the dog to pick at during the day. And I definitely know some anecdotal reports of other rescues and other people doing this in the UK and saying that there's no problem. My personal experience is no. Apart from anything else, I worry that gorging, which a dog will do if it's suddenly available, food is available to them. I worry about the physiological effects of gorging. Bloat is an awful killer of some of these dogs, some of the large breeds, and there is supposed to be a link between sort of heavy amounts of food and bloat, which can kill a dog in 30 minutes. So I personally don't believe in the self-regulation thing. I think that dogs are naturally scavengers. Any dog that goes missing and will scavenge to keep themselves alive by eating the first thing they see and finishing it, making sure they do finish it in case that's the last meal they get. And I think people will identify seeing that in their pet dogs as well.
Yeah, I agree with that. I'm not a big fan of the whole letting the dog self-regulate its own food, because otherwise there wouldn't be fat dogs, surely.
So, I mean, we certainly don't agree with grazing, do we, Nando? We don't leave food down for our dogs all day, as I know some pet owners do. But certainly, one of my dogs, Digger, I can give him a bowl, for instance, of food, which I usually give him in a toy, but if we say a bowl for now, and he'll eat half of it and then go, oh, I don't want any more. Now, with him, he is a very good size. He's never been overweight. I can just feel his ribs. He's very good. And I think that's good. I don't think he's ever going to be overweight. Now, if I force-fed more food, you know, changed the food, because, oh, my God, he didn't eat his kibble, for instance, let's give him something nicer, then he could end up being a fatty.
Oh, yeah, but I don't think he would. He's very, as an individual dog, he's very good at well... He just doesn't eat a lot, does he?
And this is what I mean by the self-regulating. I quite like that.
Yes. Yeah, it's not for most dogs is kind of what I'm saying. Now, I think that a lot of pet owners then get a little bit worried if the dog doesn't eat the full amount one day.
And this is where it can then stem the problem.
It spirals out of control, doesn't it? They start putting tuna on and gravy and different things on top of the dog's food. Now, from a medical point of view, Sandy... Adding loads of human food to a bowl of food, for instance, is that going to cause an issue?
Yeah, sure. Because as you mentioned before, the human food can be much more energetic or calorie-wise higher than the dog food. And also, certain food is not good for them to have. And And then it's also they get accustomed to that, and then probably they won't eat the kibbles anymore, and that's like, you know, like a vicious cycle. So they have to add every time more spaghetti or whatever they add to the food.
Spaghetti.
There is our problem, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah, we've got Homer Simpson in the studio. Brilliant. Oh, that's fantastic. Now, guys, if you are listening to this and you are thinking, actually, my dog might be a little bit overweight or certainly is fat, then have a look. There are some good dog weight charts that you can find online. And I'm sure that if you would like to get in touch with any one of my guests, they would be more than happy to give you some information. Jaqi, if anybody wants to get in touch with you and ask you any questions, how do they go about finding you?
I'm on the web. If you just either Google Jaqi Bunn or dog site, which is DogPsyche, if you Google that, you'll come up to my website. One last thing that I've just checked in the break on the PDSA website, and we were talking about the correlation between human obesity and canine obesity rising. And their figures say that in 2006, the national figure was 21% of pets overweight. 2009 was 35% of pets overweight.
Wow. That's ridiculous.
It's sad more than anything else.
Yeah, very true.
Yeah, so it's definitely getting worse. And my tip to people would just be, don't be offended. It's nothing to be embarrassed about. Just try and see the best side of your dog is the one where you can see a rib.
Absolutely, and I think that's just it. You know, please don't be offended. Take our advice on board if you can. We're trying to help.
Yeah, definitely.
Absolutely. Now, Sandy, if somebody wants to get in touch with you, where can they find some more information about you?
On the webpage, which is www.vitalpet.es, or sending us an email at info@vitalpet.es, or by telephone 952-850-505.
Excellent. Well, thank you very much, ladies, for joining me. It's been a very interesting subject, and I'm sure we will get a few questions in. If you do have any questions for us, then, as always, you can ring into the studio, or you can send me an email during the week, which is nando@italkfm.com, and I will put it to our listeners live on air, and I'll get back to you as well.
I have a question.
Oh, God.
Did you just call me a lady?
No, sorry, you misunderstood.
I knew it. I knew it.